Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to the service this morning. It's such a glorious morning this morning, even though it's overcast. I just think we are now starting to see the effects of the cyclone that has been with us for quite some time. As you know, I've been reading from Ezekiel chapter 37, and I continue this week. So turn with me to Ezekiel 37 as we read the first 14 verses. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, O Sovereign Lord, you..." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.' This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones: I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, 'This is what the Sovereign Lord says: Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet as a vast army. Then he said to me, 'Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the Sovereign Lord says: O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you, and you will live. I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and have done it, declares the Lord." Let us just bow our heads as we prepare to hear God's word this morning. Almighty Father, we thank you that we, as we sit here today, have the wonderful privilege of saying, Spirit of God, help me to hear what God is saying. And so this morning, Lord, I don't know how people are feeling, but some may be feeling so energetic, so aware, so alive. Speak to those folk and give them the hearts to say that it is by grace. But Lord, there may be many who are just down and downcast and just feeling so despondent. I ask this, Lord, that you would allow these folk to know that God can breathe new life into your heart and soul, to give you the strength to face a new week, even a new day, with enthusiasm. So I pray for this morning, Lord. I ask that you would allow me to speak in a manner that your people will hear and be encouraged. And also, Lord, to allow me to know that thus is what God has said through your word. So use me as your instrument, Lord, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So friends, I've been wonderfully encouraged this week as people have responded to what I've shared last week regarding this particular passage. And I spoke generally about the desolation where God allows Ezekiel to see the condition of Israel as he brings him into the valley of dry bones. And I challenged us to say, are we not like that? Are we in the dry bones with the effects of COVID? Many of us are feeling downcast, maybe even dry, spiritually dry, and we need a touch from God. And it's encouraging to know that God used Ezekiel, whose name means God strengthens. And as I said last week, he may have strengthened Ezekiel at this time in Ezekiel's life and the history of Israel, being exiled in Babylon, to say to this man, I need to use you to be my spokesman to the people of Israel. And friends, as I challenged us last week, I said God has used many, many men and women who preach the word of God to be the spokesman of yours and representatives of heaven. And we've spoken the gospel to many folk. And with the COVID, we either take the information and use it to your glory, or we just ignore it completely and become despondent. I think God was strengthening Israel through a man called Ezekiel, who God strengthens. And then the message that he was speaking, Ezekiel, through God, was a message that Israel needed to hear at the time that they were in the history of Israel at the time. Because Israel were exiled, taken over into Babylon. And there was no temple, there was no religious sacrifices, and the temple was destroyed and desecrated. And I think Ezekiel felt the pressure of not having a temple and being far away from his homeland and wanting to have that close relationship with God. And I think Ezekiel sensed, as he walked around listening to the voices and the conversations of his people in the city of Babylon, he could hear the people were despondent, and he needed to express his heart. And God looks for a man whose heart is keen to hear his word and responsive to the things of God, and God chose him. And through this word, Israel are strengthened. One of the things that I shared with you last week, and through this whole concept of God strengthens, is, are you and I walking around in our daily lives, at work, at school, at play, and just listening to what God is saying in the everyday things, the mundane things of our lives? Are we hearing God speak in the thunder? Are we hearing God speak in the cyclone? Are we hearing God speak even in the COVID? Are we hearing God speak through the voice of a little child? Or are we neglecting hearing his voice because it's too much effort for us to stop for a moment in our week, like a day on Sunday, just to spend some time with God, to separate ourselves from the world and enjoy meeting with God? It is interesting, this man called Ezekiel, he was a prophet. In actual fact, he comes from a priestly family. His father was Buzi, who was a priest. And yet, without a temple, he was a man without a position. But yet God called him. He was strange in many ways as people would look at him. He was a married man. And when his wife had died, God had said to him, do not mourn. Which was very strange in those days, because it was important for a member of the family, especially a husband, to mourn. And God said to him, don't mourn. There was a message that God was saying to the people of Israel. And he didn't mourn. But there was also a period of time where God said to him, you need to lie on your left-hand side of your body for 390 days. And he did, without moving. He lay on his left-hand side for 390 days as a sign of atoning for the people's sin. And after the 390 days, he slept on the right-hand side for 40 days, hoping that his people would hear God speak and say, atone, God has atoned for your sins. I'm a priest. I'm using that sort of effort. So it's interesting, friends, who this man was. And it's also an interesting fact about him. In this first verse, I said to you last week that the hand of the Lord was upon him. And I shared with you many people who've had their hands upon, that the Lord's had their hands upon them, like Ezra, for instance, who's experienced God's hand upon him because he was a man who studied his word, God's word, and he was determined to teach God's word. And it was the grace of God that led him. But there was also a man called David who experienced God's hand upon him, and it was a disciplinary hand. And David suffered, as I shared with you from Psalm 38. There was also a hand of God on the Lord Jesus Christ. And he was led into the wilderness to face temptation and Satan. So the desolation is an expression of the condition of Israel, and it needed a human being to intervene. But also God initiates the whole process, and we see grace in evidence in this whole passage, where we hear that God calls Ezekiel, and God allows him to go out into the wilderness, into this valley. And I said to you last week that I look at a valley, when I ever consider a valley, I think of a valley being a lush place, a place where there's life, there's animals, there's birds, there's greenery. But there's a difference here. There's a contrast here. This is a valley of bones, dry bones. And it's a metaphorical statement here, the valley of dry bones. It's God saying, look at this, at my people. They are dry. They're in the valley where there's no hope and there's no life. And so one of the wonderful things about God, he initiates restoration. And so in verse 2, I spoke to you last week. He led me back and forth among them, among the dry bones. This is God leading Ezekiel among the dry bones. And this is part of salvation, friends, is that you and I have no inclination to restore relationships with God. God makes the first step and he draws us towards him. And here we see God coming and saying, I see my people, I hear the cries of my people, and I want to help them. That's called mercy. And it's just grace that God allows himself to walk with a man amongst dry bones. Let me say this in another way, in the most popular sense, that you and I will walk around in total darkness. Without even considering God, we will look at the sunsets, we will look at the sunrise, we will look at the stars in the sky at night with our loved one next to our side. And we will never say that I need God unless God prompts your heart. And this is one of the wonderful things about God here. He looks upon his people, he hears your cry, and he says to someone who's listening to God speak, come, let me show you what is taking place in the lives of my people. And then he asks Ezekiel an interesting thing. He says to him, son of man, can these bones live? I think if I was in Ezekiel's shoes, I would say to him, are you talking to me, Lord? Because I know that I cannot allow these bones to live. I've got no skills to make these bones live. And Ezekiel responds in the most humbled way and the most wisest way. He says, O Sovereign Lord. And that's where I get my title of my message from. And the message of the title of the message is this: I am God, and there's no one other than myself, or there's no other. I am God, and there's no other. In other words, I am sovereign. And so God shows Ezekiel that there are things that we are unable to do and only he can do. And God says to him, son of man. He calls him son of man. And I said to you last week, the reason why I believe God calls him son of man is to make him aware that he is a creature. And in response, Ezekiel says to him, creator, my creator, our creator. And so as we continue with this particular study of Ezekiel chapter 37 verses 1 to 14, I want to say this to you as the next point. God will reveal the declaration. In other words, he says, I want to say something. Before in the desolation, he was saying, I see something. Now he's saying, I want to say something. I want to declare something to you, Ezekiel. And I want to read from verses 3 to 10. I want to go through that. As I shared with you, Ezekiel is walking through, led by the Spirit of God, into the valley of dry bones. I want you to understand, friends, that here in this particular text, we see the Trinity unfolding or present. So he leads him into the valley of dry bones. And here God says to him, prophesy to these bones. Say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. It is interesting to note, friends, and I want you to hear this from me quite loudly. You cannot change a man's heart by your own opinions or whatever you've heard someone else say. God speaks directly into us, into a dead heart, and he tells them, listen to my words. God's words are life, as Peter said to Jesus Christ in the boat on the Sea of Galilee. He said, Lord, you have the words of life. And here God says to Ezekiel, speak, prophesy, tell them. Dry bones, hear the word of God. You see, before that statement was made to tell him to prophesy, I think what God was saying to Ezekiel bordered on ridiculous, because it's impossible for a human being to bring anything to life. We remember from our New Testament studies that when God spoke in the form of Jesus Christ, he was able to bring the dead to life. I think Ezekiel was going to say it was in the process of seeing a miracle take place. Something of new creation expectation. And he stands there as he listens to God's word. God saying to him, speak the word. Paul said the same thing. He said it to Timothy. He said, preach the word in season and out of season. And friends, if I'm honest with you this morning, I think we're in a process of being out of season with the COVID and the closures of churches. I heard the hearts of many of the pastors this week as we gathered around the table talking about our own experiences with COVID. And I hear pastors are feeling the pinch of not having their congregations with them on a Sunday morning and going online. It is great to be online, but we need the fellowship. We need to hear and see how you're living, how you're doing, how you're coping. And so preaching the word is important if it's online, but it's difficult to speak to a camera when there's no response and there's no one to look at and see the heartbeat of a human being and the response and the smile on your face or the sadness on your face or your drooping shoulders to say that life is tough. It's difficult to preach looking at a lens. And so we need one another. And that's why Ezekiel was called the man whom God strengthens and the man who hears God's voice and the man who speaks God's word at due time and in due season. You see, Ezekiel, when he said, Sovereign Lord, he understood that this great being was unique from any other being. And he needed that opportunity just to step back and say to himself, only you, Lord, alone know what can be done. And God says to him, you now speak my word. When I read this a number of times, I was dumbfounded in the fact that God would use a man to speak on his behalf. And that's what God has done for us today. Many people will knock preaching. And I still say that's what God's choice was, is to use a human being to speak his word. And that's why I'm glad to be a Baptist, because we keep our fingers on the text and we study the text and we tell the people what the text is saying. And from the text, we preach God's word. And so Ezekiel, as he speaks, God continues to say, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter into you. I will do this. This is what God is saying. Because I'm sovereign. Because I'm sovereign, I have the power, I have the wisdom, I have the knowledge and the authority to do anything I choose in my creation. I am all powerful. I am all knowing. And I am everywhere. You see, God knows his creation because he made it. And God will allow his creation to experience decay, deterioration, and destruction so that it will accomplish his will. In other words, God is in control. And so what do I say this morning, friends? I say this simply this. is the greatest minds in the world are working together to find a cure for this COVID. They are scrambling around. But there's only one person that knows the future and knows the present, and that is God. And what am I saying further, friends, is this, that if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can know without a shadow of a doubt that God is in control and He can take care of your life to its very fullest until the very end. And He said it to His disciples, and He says it in the 21st century, that I will be with you till the very end. You see, when life becomes unbearable, chaotic, and the future looks bleak, God is still in control. Friends, this is encouraging for you and I, because God is not sitting unmoved and disinterested. Nothing takes Him by surprise. The world may change, but God says, I am the same today and forever. If this does not move you, friends, then you need to question your salvation. And so I say again, God is sovereign. There is no one else. And there's an encouraging statement for you, is that if He's sovereign, He's in control. And if He's in control and you love Him and you follow Him, you know that you're in safe hands. It says in verse 4 and 6, He said to them, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to the bones, I will make breath into you. Now I want you to notice that God tells Ezekiel to tell them that breath will come into you. Now the breath is an interesting word. It means wind, it means breath, and it means ruach. And we know that the Holy Spirit is called ruach. And so Ezekiel is told, tell them that the breath will enter them. And you'll notice that in verse 5 and verse 6, there's two little words that you and I will just read over. God does a miracle, but He says this, I will make breath, spirit, enter you. And then I will put the breath in you. Make and put is interesting little words. Because you and I, we cannot make the breath into us. God does the grace, the gracious act. God will allow the breath to be put into you and to stay there. And the day that comes when you and I will depart from this earth, God will stop that breath. But it is also a spiritual aspect. God will make His Spirit enter into your heart and soul and change you into a new person. And He's the one that will keep that Spirit within you as a guarantee for your future inheritance in heaven. God makes His breath enter the bodies and He puts it in as well. This is the new creation, the new birth. And it takes us, our responsibility is to keep that relationship going, called sanctification. Separation from the world. And friends, I've been fighting with this particular thing, this particular thought, sanctification. Yeah, we see regeneration, new birth, where God acts on our behalf. But then we've also got this our responsibility of sanctification, setting ourselves apart from the world. I think when God creates us new and fresh, He gives us a new heart and a new desire. And that's why I say to you, if you are still far away from God, but then you still call yourself a Christian, I say to you, quite honestly, test your salvation. Check if you truly are born again. Because a person who's born again is not interested in the worldly things and is interested in God's things. So friends, I also question the fact that even though we've got a church that's closed from people coming in, it's a time for us to think about what we are doing going forward. How do we do church going forward? I still say we need to speak the word of God into the hearts of people. But then we keep our fingers on the text, speaking God's word, God's way, and not making ourselves comfortable in a church with fancy technology, comfortable seats. to attract the lost. You see, for me, the lost are the people that are dry and bones have been bleached by the sun, by the things that are taking place in the world. It is burning us in a metaphorical way. And people need new life. And it's not that they're going to come to the church and find comfortable chairs and wonderful technology that's going to make their lives different. It's the Word of God speaking into a lost soul. And so I'm saying this, friends. God did not call Ezekiel into a place where there's lush gardens and say to him, bring the people here, I want to talk to them. He spoke to them in their condition. They were far from God. They have been destroyed by the worldly systems of the time with Babylon and its culture. And God spoke to them directly and said, hear the word of God. This is what gives life. This is what makes you new. This is what gives you a relationship with me. And as the people received their new bodies, there was an interesting thing that took place. I want you to look at verse 7. So I prophesied as I was commanded. Now that is what every pastor needs to understand. Speak on behalf of God as He tells you to speak. And there's something very special in that. Is that we are not here to hear what people want us to preach. We are here to preach what God wants us to preach. And Ezekiel spoke as God commanded him. And as I was prophesying, he says, there was a noise. It's an interesting thing that when God moves amongst his people, there's a rustling of people's hearts. There's tears flowing in the congregation. There's people that are moving because they're feeling uncomfortable with what is being said. And there are people that are even coming together to say sorry to one another, forgiveness. And people are coming to make right with their God. This is sacred moments, friends. And we need to understand that. And as there was a rustling amongst the bones, listen to these words, the rattling sound. And the bones came together as one body, bone to bone. And I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them. But there was no breath in them. It's interesting that as he spoke the words of God, there was a moving of the Spirit bringing them all together, but there was no breath in them. And then God says to him in verse 9, He said to me, speak, prophesy to the breath. Now listen carefully to me. I love this so much. In fact, I spoke to a friend of mine who's also a pastor. I said, can you understand the depth of this piece of scripture? Speak to the breath. A man, Ezekiel, just an ordinary man, whose designation was originally a priest because of his father and the line of the priesthood, but he was taken out of that lineage and placed in a foreign land. He had no position in the form of a calling, but God calls him to be a prophet. And God says to him, speak to the breath. Speak to the ruach. Let me say this in another way. Speak to the Holy Spirit. Now I want to say this to you, friends. This is important for me. Can you understand the depth of this? That God would say to a man, speak to the Holy Spirit. I would imagine God saying to his Holy Spirit, move amongst the people. There was a statement that I read from Spurgeon saying that God expected Ezekiel to pray to the Holy Spirit. I just think it's a matter of both. It's preaching and praying to the Holy Spirit. It's every pastor's heart, if he cares for his flock, to pray that the Holy Spirit would come and touch the hearts of his people. You see, friends, I believe in my heart of hearts, and I've watched people, and I've listened to people. I think this is the basic problem of the lethargic attitude we have in our churches, the complacency that we have in our churches, is that we are not speaking and allowing the Holy Spirit to take hold of us and make us into God's people. There's no enthusiasm. We're just living. We are listening to the other world, the world outside. We are not talking to each other. We are not speaking to God's people. We are not gathering around God's word. We are not being encouraged by God's word and listening to the men who have been called and ordained by God to speak God's word and study God's word. We are just listening to the news. We are listening to other information. And I believe that we are grieving the Holy Spirit. I believe strongly that when God says to Ezekiel, prophesy to the breath, he's saying, speak, my son, speak to the Spirit of God on behalf of your people and ask the Holy Spirit to come down. And we ask this for revivals. We say, come, Holy Spirit, come. And Ezekiel is saying the same thing. And listen to the words of Ezekiel. He says in verse 9, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man. I say to you, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, O ruach, and breathe on those slain so that they may live. It is interesting, as the bodies came together with their flesh and tendons all in place, they just stood there blank. Their eyes were glazed. Their bodies couldn't move. Their feet were standing still, but they were in mass. But there was no power to make them move. And I see a church like that today. I see us standing without enthusiasm, without any power. And we look glazed. And I say this with all my heart, friends. Ask the Spirit of God to change your heart and to come into you and make you into a vast army that will change this world and will speak the words of God. This world needs the church. If ever we need the church, it is now. Friends, when I think of a man who's, or people that are called a vast army, I look at an army and I think an army's duty is to fight a war. And I think of an individual soldier, he needs to be prepared and equipped to fight the battle. I know that a soldier needs to be ready at all times. And a soldier needs to be connected to his commanding officer at all times. And I ask you, friends, if I convert that into Christianity, we need to be ready at all times to fight the warfare that we are fighting. We are fighting spiritual battles against spiritual forces in high places. But God has given us equipment to equip ourselves. He says, I gave you the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, shoes fitted for the preparation of the gospel, and I've given you a shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit. Fight the battle. But then we need to be connected to the commanding officer, and that is Jesus Christ, who's gone through and destroyed. And he says, the gates of hell will not prevail against my kingdom. And I'm asking you this morning, are you alert? Are you self-controlled? Because your enemy prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. But the Bible says to me, resist him. Standing firm in the faith, not sitting. Standing firm in the faith, not standing firm in fear, because you've heard a story from someone else, and so you assume that this is what's going to take place. No, friend, I'm saying to you, stand firm in the faith. You see, if Moses said this to the people of Israel, be aware of the fowler's snare. The fowler's snare is that hidden little instrument that catches an animal in surprise. He says this, no harm will befall you. No disaster can come near you. Because even, and you may say, yeah, but there are many Christians that have passed away, and I know that there's a couple that have passed away this week because of COVID. But friends, what he says this, what he means is this, is that even though death may come to us, we do not have to worry because we know that we are home. We don't belong here. But in the meantime, you're going to be facing the secrets of Satan and his cohorts. Listen to these words. Surely he will save you from the foulest snare, that hidden little trap in the grass that you are unaware of, and that you all of a sudden walk into it and you are trapped by it and brings you down. He says, beware, be aware, because when you're aware, God will save you. And from the deadly pestilence, does that not sound familiar? That's floating in the air and we just breathe it in unexpectedly. Before you know it, you're sick. And then he says, do not fear for the terror of night or the arrow that flies by day. It comes silently and swiftly and enters into your heart and it destroys you because you've now opened up yourself to the things of the world. Jesus said, I do not give myself to men because I know the hearts of men. Can I ask you the solution? Can I tell you the solution? Psalm 91 verse 1 and 2. It says, he who dwells. You see, the point of the matter is when I'm dwelling in the shelter of the Most High, Sovereign Lord, when I spend time with Him, when I come close to Him, when I'm walking in His footsteps, I'm on safe ground. He says, when I rest in the shadow of the Almighty, that's my commanding officer. I'm behind him. As the sun is shining against him, I hide in his shadow. But I'm not scared because he's the one that goes ahead of me and he prepares the way. And so God demonstrates his power. But he also asks you and I to be prepared. And are you and I prepared? And that's what this particular passage of Scripture is all about. And then lastly, the demonstration. I will show you something. You see, God shows them something. He takes these dead bones and he brings them into a group of united people, a vast army, and then he breathes life into them. Look at verses 11 to 14. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. And we know today, since 1948, Israel has become a nation. And they've got land. But even today, the world is fighting for that little piece of land. Only God will sort this thing out. And when it happens, friends, I say this now, be aware and woe to you who stand and touch the anointed of God. He said to me, son of man, these are the bones of the whole of Israel. They will say, or they say, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. Is that you? Is that me? Yes, I say so. It's sometimes me. My hope is sometimes gone. But where do I find hope? When I spend my time with the Lord Jesus Christ. I got a call from someone who said to me, they feel hopeless. They are so despondent. They feel despair. And you know what I said to them? I said, spend time with God. And then I put the phone down after having a conversation with them. And then I realized that's not only the answer. We need to sing to God, praise Him. And I said, find some music that you can sing as you read God's word and then sing to Him. I remember the years when I was a kid and I used to walk home from school and I used to walk through a little bit of a felt to get to my house, a shortcut. I used to sing. I used to sing songs that come from my heart. And it wasn't Christian songs. And that's the sad reality about it. But I wish I could get those days back where I could just sing to Him at any time of the day. Just sing and sing from my heart. Now that I'm old and I know more. And friends, I want to cultivate that and I'm encouraging you to cultivate that. Is sing to God. But now that you're old and you know the Word of God, use those words and put them into music. Sing. Sing to Him and say thank you. And then that lifting of despondency comes off your shoulders. The spirit of heaviness is when we pray, when we sing. And then he says in verse 12, therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says, I am God. And he says, oh my people, I'm going to open up your graves. Sometimes we feel as though we're in this abyss. We come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and then we find ourselves in greater difficulty than before. And we feel as though the world has collapsed on us. And I say this to you, let God open the grave of your life and let the grave clothes be taken off you as he did with Lazarus. Call upon Jesus and he will answer you. I'm talking from experience, friends. I often sit back and I think to myself, the years that I've been living, how God's hand has guided me and protected me and pushed me to the side, because otherwise I would never have taken the direction that he wanted me to take unless he pushed me gently to the sides that he wanted me to go, the road that he wanted me to go. And I say thank you to him because I am one of his people. I'm his precious, precious possession, and so are you. If we just get closer to him and allow the Spirit of God to move in our hearts. I'm calling us to holiness, friends. I'm calling us to have a realistic relationship with Jesus Christ. And then he says in verse 13, and I want to close with this, then you, my people, will know with your mind and with your heart, you will know that I am sovereign when I open your grave. When I open your grave, not man, not Ezekiel, he will. He does the supernatural because man can do nothing. We will open up a grave and we'll find a dead body. God opens up the grave and he lifts you up from the dead. He looks at things that are dead and calls them as if they're living. He opens up the grave. And I will settle you in your own land. Let me say this, and I said this to Lee McCabe, Franz McCabe's son, when he phoned me to tell me that his father and mother have passed away. I said, I've got a sadness on my heart. I had a deep sadness on my heart. And I said this to him, as much as I'm saddened, deeply saddened at the news, your dad and your mother are in a place where they've been wanting to be for many, 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 many years. You see, friends, a Christian doesn't drop his roots in the soil of earth. We look, we're only passing through. We look to a land whose king is Jesus Christ. And we long to be there. So I hope this morning you were encouraged, and I pray that you'd continue to study Ezekiel 37. Let us pray. Almighty Father, I thank you for this opportunity that I have had, and I'm sure your people will continue to study this particular passage. And I pray, Lord, that as I've learned so much, that they would learn even more. So that when we gather together, even in homes or wherever the case may be in the conditions that we are in right now, that instead of us speaking words that are not edifying, we will speak words of encouragement and to strengthen us and to build us up in the faith. And I pray that Ezekiel will come to our lips and let us speak of how he experienced the sovereignty of God. I ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Friends, enjoy the Lord's day and may you have a blessed week. Thank you so much. God bless.
Ezekiel stared down into the valley, filled with dried bones baking in the sun. Remains that used to be a mighty army, to him it looked like the fighting days were done. But driven by your calling on his life, you spoke God's words, the bones began to shake. He stared wide-eyed as the flesh began to form, and as he prophesied to the wind, the soldiers began to wake, and the Lord sent his wind into into the valley and breathe the breath of life into their souls and raise them again a mighty army. For soon these arisen warriors will battle again, for they have been filled with the Spirit. Before his congregation, once a mighty